Jesus is condemned to death. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Let us die on the holy cross to have redeemed the world.
It is Friday, early in the morning. Jesus is brought from Pilate, the high priest, to Pontius Pilate, the governor, on trumped up charges of treason, and is condemned to death. Judas, his betrayer, seeing that Jesus was to be condemned, deeply regretted what he had done. He tried to return the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and elders, saying,
"I've seen betraying innocent blood. What is that to us? Look to it yourself."
Judas was in despair and ran away to meet his death. The governor questioned Jesus about the charges of treason, asking him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus replied,
"So you say."
Pilate then addressed the chief priests and the crowds.
"I find this man not guilty."
The crowd, inciting the other leaders, kept shouting,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate spoke to them, wishing to release him.
"Why? What evil has this man done? I find no crime in him deserving of death."
They persisted with their cries,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate saw no reason to crucify Jesus. He knew he was being used. He felt he had to act and not to be perceived as weak. As he prepared to pass judgment, he hesitated.
"I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your responsibility."
With that, he rushed inside and left Jesus in the hands of the soldiers. They delivered him to be crucified.
The cries of "Crucify! Crucify!" still ring in our ears. The picture of Pilate facing, asking the crowd leaders and people, "Shall I crucify your king?" And their response, "We have no king but the emperor," is an image that haunts me. It haunts me because of the harshness and injustice of it all. But mostly it haunts me because I see this injustice, this harshness in myself.
Jesus stands, strong in his silence. He is condemned to die for a crime he did not commit. He has been betrayed by a friend, falsely accused and judged wrongly. And yet, he accepts his punishment without protesting. How many times have I been the one to persecute or judge others without question, without thought, without even a tear? Oh Lord, give me the grace to choose humiliation over pride. Help me to bear wrongs done to me with love and forgiveness, and forgive me for the times that I allow an innocent person to suffer.
People fail to see, even as they gather on the streets to gossip and to stare. the sight that we, his executioners, close our hearts to, lest we somehow end up feeling the pain, the burden that the one who is afflicted must carry, the burden that he did not earn, without a word, in silence.
Lord Jesus, you accepted the cross, even though it did not belong to you, even though you did not deserve it. You carried the burden that belongs to us. Teach us how to bear each other's burdens.
We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you.
Because by your
They seized Simon of Cyrene, put the cross on his shoulders as he stands beside Jesus, and made him help shoulder the load.
It was the only thing to do, a thing we have done 100 times. A perfect stranger, coming into the city, just happened to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. I demanded that he be grabbed and forced to take hold of the cross. I was relieved when the guards chose someone out of the crowd to help. I was ashamed that I could not bring myself to step out of character, out of my role, to help the man.
Lord Jesus, we thank you for strangers in our midst. We often unwittingly, even unwillingly, show us what to do and how to do it. Open our eyes and hearts, enlarge our vision, that we may be the ones who help you and others to bear the unbearable load.
Lord, we have often prayed for you.
We have struck off the burdens of others so carelessly. We have neglected mercy and loving kindness. We think only of ourselves. Forgive us.
Thank you.
the God-forsaken place, Golgotha, where Jesus will be crucified. Hurriedly, roughly, his clothes are stripped from his back, leaving him naked in front of the crowd, naked, exhausted, and humiliated. They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots.
We stripped him. Our job is to make sure there is nothing left of a man to mar him as a man, to expose him, to humiliate him. We did our job. Jesus just stands there, swaying, with nothing. We took his clothes. We took his dignity. Yet, in some strange way, I find myself caring more than I ever have before. I want nothing to do with taking his clothing. I will let the men gamble for it after we nail his Jesus to the cross.
Dear Lord, we reach out and grasp freely for so much, searching for what will satisfy. We do not know how to let go of things and let you in. Even when we want to bring healing and wholeness, we get caught up in deeds that bring the opposite. Forgive us.
Because by your holy cross you have redeemed the world.
51, he gasps out the words, "It is finished." After 3 mercifully brief hours on the cross, suspended between earth and sky, he bows his head and gives up his spirit. Jesus has died.
The gambler didn't last long, so I watched Jesus die. It was unnaturally dark during the time he spent dying, but I saw enough, more than enough. I heard the passersby said about him as they mocked him, and I heard the words he spoke to his mother and his friend, and what he said to the thief on the cross next to him. I heard all his cries, and I saw his agony. Indeed, I looked into his eyes and saw his sorrow. I was there when he breathed his last with a great cry, and I saw a spear digging his flesh, the spear ordered to be thrust into him to make sure that he was dead. And I saw blood and water pour out on his side, down his spear, down his legs, and to the ground. Death. Violence and death. I hung my head. I could no longer see, for the tears had flowed like his blood down my face. And I could not stop the words that came to my lips, as unbidden as the tears. Truly this man was God's son. Oh, why did I have a hand in this? How could I have let it happen?
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. I am poured out in water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like an osprey, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of
Savior, lend my
station. Jesus is buried in the tomb. We adore you, O Christ, and we praise you. Relatives and friends, carry the body to the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, a rich man who was also a disciple of Jesus. They laid his body, wrapped in a clean linen cloth, in the new tomb, which had been carved out of the hill, and they rolled over across the entrance and silently withdrew.
The place where they laid the body to rest was in a garden. The garden seemed strangely silent and still as I stole into it to watch them. My mind and my body were in shock. Images registered on my brain, but I no longer felt anything. It was over. This Jesus, this one that I, for some reason, had called the Son of God, had died. I knew my life would never be the same, but what it would be, I could not say. All I knew was that he was gone, gone, and I did not know him, and I did not know him. I went away and wept bitterly.
Loving God, accepting your word that you did not hold nor spare even in your own son, but gave him up for all of us. Teach us what this means. Give us new hope. We ask it in his name. Amen.
Lord, when you were buried, it seemed like the end of everything you promised and stood for. But it wasn't. It was only the beginning. As we travel tonight from the crucifixion through the vigil of Easter to the resurrection, be with us in a special way to help us recall and reflect in our hearts who you are and what you have done for us. Father, send down your loving blessing upon your people who have devoutly recalled the death of your Son. Grant us pardon and bring us comfort. May our faith grow stronger and eternal salvation be assured. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. This concludes our Living Stations of the Cross. We thank you for joining us this evening.